I want to start out with a little word association game. This is a silent word of association. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to read off four names. What y'all do is just remember, just retain the first word that comes to your mind. Okay? When I say it. All right, you ready? All right, the first, Joseph Stalin. The second, Pol Pot. Third, the Islamic State. And fourth is Adolf Hitler. Now, I am convinced that if I wagered, I probably would win the bet that most of y'all, probably the first word that came to your mind is the word evil. Now, these people I just mentioned are probably the most notorious 20th and 21st century mass murderers and the most prolific persecutors in modern history. Combined, and this is staggering, but combined it is estimated that between them, that they persecuted and murdered over 37 million people in the world. Now, when I was doing my research, there was a lot higher estimates, but I kind of went through and did a lot of research, and the most nauseating average I could come together was the 37 million. Now, of course, Joseph Stalin tops the list, and he is a pretty significant leader in that. The Islamic State came in last. Now, with that general knowledge, it's not surprising that if you look up and read any recorded associated word association surveys, that evil is the most common word associated with these people. The word monster came in second. The pain and death these guys orchestrated is really just about incomprehensible. It's kind of hard to wrap your head around it. But there's something that a lot of times we don't think about, and it's kind of even more mind-boggling. It's about the thousands, maybe even hundreds of thousands, of people that it took to do the day-to-day hands-on acts of atrocities, masterminded by these people. They couldn't do it all by themselves. Now, I want you to think about this as I read verse 9 in our epistle reading today. It's the 12th chapter of St. Paul's letter to the Romans. The epistle is verses 6 through 16, and this is verse 9. Let love be without dissimulation. Abhor that which is evil. Cleave to that which is good. I looked up abhor, and according to Webster's, abhor is to regard with extreme repugnance, to feel hatred or loathing for. To loathe. Now here's the same verse in the NIV. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Now St. Paul's teaching is basically common sense Christianity. Love without hypocrisy. Love sincerely. Love unconditionally. Hate cruelty. Hate murder. Hate violence, in a sense, practically hate itself. Cling or stay faithful to love, charity, mercy, cling and be faithful to God. Now when we think about it, you think, okay, well that's kind of common sense and that's kind of the easy part. And for most practicing Christians, they almost feel that they've talked themselves in that that's almost second nature for them. But when St. Paul in this epistle reading, he moves the goalpost on us in chapter 14. Bless them which persecute you. Bless and curse not. Wait a minute, just five verses ago, St. Paul told us to abhor, to hate the Stalins, the Hitlers of this world. Now he's telling us to bless some of the most cruel and murderous persecutors in the history of mankind. Now, St. Paul in verse 9 didn't say, abhor those who are evil. He said, abhor that which is evil. The hardest pill for us Christians to swallow, and we do swallow it, but it's hard, is the pill of separating the sinner from the sin. Now, I know these examples, of course, are of the extreme. I get that. But I did it for a reason. In our day-to-day lives, in our worlds, we're busy. And a lot of times we just associate sin with a transgression. Oops, a little moral deficiency. That's my bad. Of course, we feel guilt about it. They're insults to ourselves and to others. And on serious cases, we do consider an insult to God. What St. Paul is truly teaching us is that sin, not the sinner, but all sin, has its origins in evil. Now, but because we can't see that origin, we can't see it, we can't visualize it, the old Adam in us, many times, wants us to point a finger, wants us to have a victim, wants us to put a face with the blame we want to put on it. The old Adam in us wants us to judge. Hate is a very ugly word. It's an ugly word. Nobody likes it. And it's not one you would usually associate with St. Paul, much less God. Proverbs chapter 8, verse 13. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil, pride and arrogancy, and the evil way, and the forward mouth do I hate. Proverbs chapter 6, this is verses 16 through 19. There are six things which the Lord hates. Yes, seven, which are an abomination to him. Haughty eyes, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood. A heart that devises wicked plans, feet that run rapidly to evil, a false witness who utters lies, the one who spreads strife among brothers. I did some research, and the words abhor and hate are found 181 times in the Old Testament. They're only found 40 times in the New Testament. And the context, in most cases, are completely opposite. We are commanded by God by the New Covenant, to hate only these things: sin and its origin, evil. Now, something doesn't come from nothing. Evil didn't manifest itself. Evil is the manifestation of Satan and Satan alone. Only by hating sin can we see it for what it truly is. Our abhorrence and our hate for it is a defense against it. Hating and judging the sinner only makes Satan stronger. But hating the sin and loving and forgiving the sinner weakens and enrages him. I kind of made myself a pledge. From now on in the morning, of course, I'm going to pray to have the strength to live a righteous life in God's eyes, and at the same time make Satan so mad, so ticked off, that his eyes explode. I think that's a pretty good way to have a great day. Now, in conclusion, and most importantly, there is always that one sinner we seem to judge and point our fingers at the most. The one we so often believe is the worst, and sometimes, in worst cases, evil, the most evil sinner in the world. The face we tend to most often put on that blame, it's the one we tend to hate the most, ourselves. Hating that sinner, hating the face we see in the mirror, is the one that makes Satan the strongest. We are all children of God, and through baptism, we're brothers and sisters in Christ. So through God's holy word and prayer, we need to make it a second nature to separate the sinner from sin. Hating our own sin instead of ourselves will allow us to see our sins for what they really are. They're evil. Evil, and help drive them, and if we see them as evil, that evil will help drive them out of our lives. Being penitent and asking God for forgiveness will strengthen our love for him. And that is the foundation for clinging to what is the origin of everything that is good: God's unmeasurable love for us. Amen.
Amen.
Remember the words of our Lord Jesus, how he said, it is more blessed to give than to receive.